Good evening, everyone. Welcome to this very special evening. I'm Max Liu. I'm the President and Vice Chancellor of the University of Surrey. I'd like to thank the Royal Institution for hosting us tonight. Tonight, we are blessed to be in the presence of two inspirational, entertaining figures in the scientific community. So I shall keep this introduction very brief. As many of you know, Professor Jim Akhlili was just flashed on the screen. He's not just an esteemed professor at the University of Surrey. He's also a renowned presenter of the BBC's famous program, A Life Scientific, who across his career has made science more accessible to millions of people. Tonight's event is part of our university's long-standing, much-cherished Jim Meets series, which took form after Jim interviewed Lord Robert Winston in September 2009, and the year Surrey hosted the British Science Festival. Since then, Jim has been fascinating us by interviewing well-known figures like Sir David Attenborough, and who brought the wild side of our planet to our living rooms, and the Archbishop of Canterbury, who assured us that, yes, science and faith can share a cup of tea. Tonight, we have a stellar guest for you, Professor Kip Thorne, a joint winner of the Nobel Prize for Physics in 2017. Kip needs little introduction, and his achievements are many and wide-ranging. His work on gravitational waves proves that what goes around comes around, especially in space-time. Kip is not just an ordinary Nobel Prize laureate. He's also someone who has managed to make theoretical physics a topic of discussion at our dinner tables, alongside politics, or whatever the amazing series that you're watching on telly. With his book, The Warped Side of the Universe, Our Universe, Kip has shown us that the universe is not only stranger than we have imagined, but perhaps it's even more strange than we can ever imagine. And let us not forget his contribution as exec producer and the science advisor on the film, the blockbuster film, Interstellar, connecting audiences around the world with complex scientific concepts. The film includes this line I really enjoy, and let me just recite this. We must reach beyond our own lifespans. We must think, not as individuals, but as a species. This spirit of the collective future-facing endeavor encapsulates the mission and the philosophy of the sponsors of tonight's event, the John Templeton Foundation. Since its inception, the Sir John Templeton Foundation has awarded over 5,000 grants, totaling $2 billion, acting as global catalyst for discoveries that help mankind to flourish. The foundation also has generously awarded the University of Surrey $3 million for the project Life on the Edge, an interdisciplinary research project headed by our own Jim Akhlili and Dr. Andrea Rocco. So they aim to investigate the distinct ways in which the passage of time and quantum physics manifest in inorganic matters as compared to living organisms. So, without further ado, let's dive into the cosmos of enlightening conversation and enjoy the evening that promised to be out of this world. Jim and Kip, the stage is yours.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you, Max, for that introduction. Well, good evening, everyone. Welcome to what I guarantee will be a fabulous 80 minutes. We're going to get going in a couple of minutes. I just want a bit of housekeeping just to let you know what's happening, following on from what Max has said. As you're aware, for the next hour or so, I'll be asking Kip about his life, his career, and all things astrophysics. And then, of course, we'll open it up to the floor to you to ask questions for the last 20 minutes. So please have a think about what you want to ask Kip. Apparently, if it's anything to do with black holes, Kip's answer is going to be the same, which is...
Because Stephen Hawking said so.
There we go. So, so we get that out of the way. Don't ask him those questions because you want a more interesting answer.
I am able to elaborate.
You are able to elaborate, exactly. You can say more about the subject. So the event is part of, as Max said, an outreach activity that is in turn part of this large international collaboration led by the University of Surrey, funded by the John Templeton Foundation, and is built as part of this series that I've been hosting for many years at Surrey. The interview and Q&A, of course, as again, I'm sure you're all aware, is being recorded for the Life Scientific. I'm very pleased to have, Kip's been one of my heroes for most of my career. Well, I've had Roger Penrose, I've had Edward Witten, so the triumvirate is complete now. It's wonderful. We'll be editing down this the hour's interview plus a selection of the very best questions and answers for the radio program, and that'll make the final cut. The episode will air, if you want to make a note of it, on August the 6th. It'll be the last in our forthcoming series. Now, we want radio listeners to know we're in front of a live audience, right? So we're not going to pretend we're recording this in a studio. So we very much welcome your reactions, laughter, gasps, heckles. Keep the heckles, Less keen on hearing ringtones, all right? So please turn your phones off or at least keep them to silent. And of course, as you can probably see, there are cameras. The University of Surrey are filming the event tonight, and that video is going to be shared on our YouTube page, after the program. The BBC were very adamant about this. We couldn't share the video until after the Life Scientific airs. Okay, I'm going to start off with a brief introduction to Kip, which will finish me welcoming him to the Life Scientific. So when you hear that, please give him a really good round of applause, okay? And so if we're all set, Tim, Andy? Yeah. Fantastic. Right, good. Get going to the program proper. Hello, and thank you for joining me here at London's Royal Institution for a special edition of the Life Scientific, one that'll take us on a journey in space and time, through black holes and wormholes to giant experimental labs and Hollywood studios. My guest is Kip Thorne, Emeritus Professor of Theoretical Physics at Caltech, the California Institute of Technology, and someone who's had a huge impact on our understanding of Einstein's theory of gravity. An early fascination with the subject led Kip to break new ground in the study of black holes, and his work as part of the team that recorded gravitational waves for the very first time, the product of a collision between two massive black holes more than a billion light years away, earned him a share in the 2017 Nobel Prize for Physics. As if that wasn't enough, he subsequently took astrophysics to the movies, developing the original idea behind Christopher Nolan's time travel epic Interstellar, and since then, acting as the scientific advisor on various big screen projects, most recently the spectacular and highly acclaimed Oppenheimer. There can't be many physicists who've had a hand in a Nobel Prize and an Oscar, but Kip seems to have found a way to span those seemingly disparate universes. Perhaps there's a wormhole involved. Kip Thorne, welcome to the Life Scientific. Now, I mentioned the project that led to the first recording of gravitational waves, which then subsequently earned you a Nobel Prize. And gravitational waves are going to crop up quite a bit over the next half an hour of the program. So can I ask you to set out in basic terms what they are?
Gravitational waves, you can think of as ripples in the shape of space that are generated by things like colliding black holes or the birth of the universe and travel at the same speed as light does, bringing us detailed information about their source.
And of course, they were predicted by Einstein's general theory of relativity.
Einstein conceived his general theory of relativity. I prefer to call it his general relativity laws, because it's not a theory in, without basis. His general, in 1915, and within about 6 months, he used his general relativity laws to predict gravitational waves.
Incredibly, though, it took a whole 100 years before they were actually confirmed to really exist.
Indeed, because it was so very, very difficult.
Well, we're going to hear a bit more, Kip, about the project that finally was successful in detecting them. I also mentioned the movie connection. Now, and we're going to come back to that too, but I have to ask, in your experience, how concerned is Hollywood about getting the science, or in your case, the physics right, versus telling a good story?
It depends on the director. It depends on the movie. I love many movies that are what you might call science fantasy.
Right.
But for hard science fiction, serious directors like Christopher Nolan are very concerned about getting the science right. Though in Chris's case, when we agreed to collaborate on this, he came on. I had been involved in starting the movie. He came on board later, but took the whole thing over and ran with it. I said to him, I hope that you will agree that nothing in the movie will violate well-established physical laws, and all of the wild speculation will come from science and not from the brain of a screenwriter. And his response was, I am enthusiastic about that as long as it does not get in the way of making a great movie.
Fair enough. There have to be compromises.
But we can, I should say that we quickly discovered that I was not going to play the science police, and that he was going to do make every effort to collaborate with me in getting the science right. It just became a fabulous collaboration, brainstorming collaboration.
I guess a biopic like Oppenheimer is different because it's history, not science fiction. In terms of your advisory role on that movie, I guess it must have also helped that you knew J. Robert Oppenheimer personally.
Yes, it did. In fact, I was the only person that Chris ever met who knew Oppenheimer. I was the only one old enough.
Still around. Okay, let's explore how old you are, Kip. Let's go back to the start. You were born in June 1940 in Logan, Utah. What was it like growing up in Utah?
It was an idyllic childhood. This was a Mormon town, 99.5% Mormons, and a sprinkling of Protestants and Catholics. I think nothing beyond that. A few Jews. I wound up marrying one. But I was never exposed to Judaism in that culture. But I grew up in a family with one foot in the Mormon church and one foot out, and so it was a very interesting growing up.
Your father was a professor of soil chemistry, I believe, at what's now Utah State University. Tell me about him.
So he grew up on a farm in northern Utah, and so that was a fairly natural thing for him to become a professor of soil chemistry. He actually matured and became a real man with real intellectual interests by serving on a mission for the Mormon Church, coming to London, and preaching the Mormon gospel in Hyde Park,
just down the road down from here.
And he described to his children how he was always often heckled by the same person. And so he would go off to a pub with this guy who would heckle him, and they would argue and talk philosophy afterwards, after he had finished preaching. They became fast friends, and the whole process of interacting with the outside world, having grown up on a small farm in rural Utah, that was a tremendous thing for him to really learn about the world and get a broad view on what goes on in the real world broadly.
Mm. Mm. Your mother also hoped for a career as an academic, but Utah state laws at the time put a stop to that.
That's right. Now, she had a PhD in economics, one of the very few women of that era. But she was not allowed to teach at the university because my father taught there. And there were what they called nepotism laws that said that the wife couldn't, well, the spouse couldn't teach.
Whichever way around,
it was always the same way.
Yeah, it was always the same, yeah.
And so she became a community activist instead.
And she wrote a book called Leave the Dishes in the Sink, Adventures of an Activist in Conservative Utah. She gave talks about the importance of bringing up children to think creatively. And I wonder, was that something that you were the eldest of five, so you and your four younger siblings, were you aware of that?
Oh, we were very much aware of that. We were aware that we were being encouraged to think for ourselves and not just follow some dictates that were being preached to us. Each of her children, they found their own really exciting project to work on, and then she would help them dig deep into the project and learn how to dig for themselves. In my case, it was astronomy.
So training to become a research scientist, I guess.
In some sense, yes, already at age 8.
Wow. Certainly, as you say, your mother was the person who fanned your interest in science and the solar system as well.
Yeah,
love.
So she took me to a lecture. Before that, I wanted to be a snowplow driver because that was the most powerful job in the world. For a small child in Utah with the snow piled up by the snowplows to twice the height of my father. But then she took me to a lecture about the solar system by a professor from the local university. And I just fell madly in love with that. And so she showed me how to do a calculation to build a scale model of the solar system, how to scale the sizes down so the sun was 4 feet in diameter. We didn't use meters in those days. On the corner in front of our house, and the planets were tiny, tiny dots almost going on down the street, and Pluto was out. Pluto was a planet then. Pluto was off off in the next town. And seeing the enormous distances between the planets and how small they were compared to those distances in this graphic way was really fabulous for me.
It was around the age of 13, I gather, that you decided physics was the path for you, especially after discovering the great physicist George Gamow's book, 1-2-3 Infinity.
Yes.
Wonderful popular science book. And with rather lovely symmetry, some years later, when you were a published researcher, Gamow then got in touch with you.
Yeah, so I had published a paper about anisotropies in the universe that might have been produced by primordial magnetic fields. Just a weird idea that really wasn't right, but it caught his fancy and caught my fancy. So he wrote to me and said he was asked me some questions about it, and I responded and said, well, I'm in this because of you. I read 1-2-3 Infinity 7 times when I was 13 years old. And he, by return mail, sent me a copy of 1-2-3 Infinity in Hungarian, inscribed with, to my dear colleague Kip Thorne, so he would not be able to reread it an 8th time.
Very good. Well, back to your teenage years, Kip Thorne. Although physics was your first love, you also had a very busy extracurricular calendar, lots of hobbies.
Lots of hobbies. I put together with friends a rock band in the early days of rock. Well, it was more of a dance band. We played church dances with a 5-piece band. We played high school dances with a 12-piece band. I was on the debate squad, and I was just having a glorious time. Mm. And then I was also doing various science hobbies, as my mother had taught me to do.
And you mentioned the church. You were brought up in the Mormon faith. But as a teenager getting into science, your religious views did start to change quite significantly, didn't they? And was that a difficult time for you?
It was not difficult for me as it was for a number of my friends who also went a similar route because of the family I'd grown up in, because of the way I'd been taught to think for myself. Mm. But I did have the experience that at age probably 13, I was to be advanced in the priesthood. It's a strange religion where there are two types of priesthood, one for teenage boys and the other for adults, only for males. And So I went to be interviewed by the bishop, and the bishop asked, do you pay an honest tithing? Well, throughout the time period I was growing up, at that age anyway, I had jobs. I had a paper route. I worked in a jewelry store. I worked in an ice cream factory. I said, yes, I do. I give it to the old folks' home. And the bishop said, that doesn't count. You have to give it to the church. You're 10% of your income. You're supposed to give it to the church. I said, the church is very wealthy. The church doesn't need it. The old folks home needs it. And he said, but that's not what God says. And I said, if God is the kind of God that we think he should be, then he would prefer I give it to the old folks home. And so
good answer for the age of 13. I gather years later, when your mother was quite elderly, she encouraged the whole family to resign from the church.
Yes. So there is an issue of discrimination against women the Mormon Church had come out very strongly against. There was an amendment to the American Constitution called the Equal Rights Amendment that declared women equal to men, and that laws had to enforce that. And the Mormon Church had come out very strongly against the Equal Rights Amendment. And as a result of that, largely, my mother encouraged us all to leave the church. One of my sisters wrote a letter to the church authorities saying we requested to be removed from the church rolls. They immediately removed my mother and my sisters. They would not remove me and my brother because we had this little low-level priesthood. And they told, Bishop came around to my house and said, you must pray every day for a year. And asked the Lord, do you really want me to leave? And I said, who am I supposed to pray to, since I really am skeptical that there's a God up there? And so we were just talking past each other. But after a year, they came around again and said, do you want out? And I said, yes, I still want out. But I should emphasize that it was an issue that I lost interest in religion. It's not that I saw fundamental incompatibilities between religion and science. And I've tried to be clear to this about this, to particularly to my high school friends who are still faithful in the church. I saw how powerful science can be for understanding the universe and for technology that makes life better for people. And I didn't see that kind of power coming from religion. And so I just lost interest.
Okay. Well, in 1958, you headed off to university to study physics at Caltech. How did you find it there?
I had a rough time for the first year and a half. I came out of this small high school in northern Utah. I had not had calculus. Most of the other kids had had calculus in their schools. I struggled, but the other thing that I found was that almost everybody else's brains worked faster than mine. I had a slow operating brain. I was a slow thinker. And so I realized that if I was going to really make it, that I had to learn things more deeply than other people did with my slow brain, so I didn't have to revisit them later on to relearn them. And so I developed my own strategies for doing that. And by about a year and a half in, I was doing okay.
Seems to have worked out since, anyway.
Yeah.
Well, in the summer before your fourth year at Caltech, Kip, you did some research, some astrophysics calculations for the astronomer Jesse Greenstein. What was that about?
So Jesse was an astrophysicist, the first astrophysicist to really take radio astronomy seriously, both from the point of view of theory as well as experiment. But he, together with Leverett Davis, had developed a theory to explain polarization of starlight. So many stars had their light that comes to Earth is polarized, like you polarize light with a polarized glasses. And there was a big mystery about how what was doing that. And they had a theory that it was caused by the light scattering off of elongated dust particles that are lined up inside an interstellar magnetic field. Sounds strange and unlikely. It turned out to be right, but he said there's an alternative possibility that you have a mixture of starlight that's coming from electrons spiraling in a magnetic field that's around the star, sort of like the Van Allen belts around the Earth. And so why don't you work out that theory and then see if that can really be successful also in explaining this. And so I spend a summer working out the theory of synchrotron radiation from electrons and magnetic fields around stars, and it was a marvelous experience.
And you ended up getting a paper out of it.
I published an enormous paper that was so long that it was published as a supplement to the Astrophysical Journal. They didn't want to publish it inside the journal because it was too long. They published it as a supplement. But it was my first experience doing scientific research on my own, although I had designed rocket engines for Thiokol Chemical Corporation as earlier than that as an undergraduate. So I had done engineering projects, big science engineering projects before that. This was my first real experience with astrophysics science.
But all still while an undergraduate. I should say that amidst of all this hard work, during your third year at university, you married your first wife, Linda. You're divorced now, but you've remained close friends. In fact, I gather Linda and your two children with her accompanied you and your current wife, Carol Lee, to the Nobel ceremony a few years back.
Yes, no, we are very good friends. We've also gone on vacation together from time to time. And the journalists in Sweden were quite taken by the idea that here's this guy who comes out of Mormon background. He brings two wives and two children. And so I was asked to do an interview for Swedish television about this. They said, the journalist said, of course, we're not going to try to do anything to embarrass you. On the contrary. The question was, who gets the first dance at the ball? Questions like this.
You put them straight, presumably. Okay, Kip Thorne, back to your studies. For your PhD, you applied to Princeton, which at the time was the leading center for research in the area that you wanted to focus on, general relativity, which, of course, as the theory gives us our most current and most precise description of gravity and space-time. But back in the early 60s, general relativity wasn't a fashionable subject, was it? Even Jesse Greenstein had told you he didn't think it was something worth pursuing.
When I told him I was going to go to Princeton to work with John Wheeler in relativity, Jesse said, I don't think that relativity is ever going to be relevant to anything in the universe except the Big Bang, and we already know all about the Big Bang.
So what was the attraction for you then?
I had fallen in love with this at age 13, reading George Gamow's book, 1, 2, 3, Infinity, and then following my nose and reading other things. And so I was just totally excited by the idea of warped space and time, and that could somehow be responsible for gravity. And I wanted to understand this. I wanted to understand this deeply, and so.
While we're talking about this fascination with relativity, it reminds me of a story involving you of mine a few years ago. You may remember I was making a TV documentary about gravity, and at the last minute I realized that I'd made a mistake in my description of how the Earth's gravity causes time to slow down. I got in touch with you. It must have been around Christmas 2020, something like that, to check. And you very kindly had a look and came back saying, yes, Jim, I think you've bleeped up. Do you remember that?
I remember that.
I was very grateful.
Because it is a really interesting problem in relativity and with a beautiful solution.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if we have time to go. we don't, just a tiny, very, very, my producer tells me we have very, very, basically it was to look how far, see how fast clocks tick.
Yes,
there's two theories of relativity. Yeah. Special relativity says they tick, time goes slower when you move fast. General relativity says time goes slower in a stronger gravitational potential. So what if you put a clock at the North Pole and a clock at the equator? Which one runs faster? And I was trying to do a calculation to balance the two. And it turns out, as you explained, no, they tick at the same rate because they're sent of the same potential surface. So this is probably going to get cut, isn't it? This is this is just for the... This is for the RI audience.
I did write with Roger Blanford, who came out of Cambridge.
Right.
I wrote a textbook, Modern Classical Physics, an unbelievably thick textbook, in which this is discussed in detail.
Okay, I clearly missed that section. But as a result of your help, you then got involved in the documentary, and I recall you saying when I spoke to you on film that one way of understanding why the apple falls to the ground is because of the curvature of space-time, and more profoundly, because the apple wants to get to the place where time runs the slowest.
Yeah.
That's so beautiful, and it's also correct.
And it's all correct. Einstein in 1912, before general relativity had reached fruition, when he was just in the process of trying to formulate the key ideas, he recognized this, and he wrote a paper on this. And that paper is beautifully encapsulated by the aphorism that things like to go where time runs most slowly, and gravity pulls them there. And then it's a mathematical formula for the relationship between the pull of gravity and the slowing of time.
I've never understood when people don't find physics beautiful, poetic, spiritual. That's a perfect example of it.
Yeah, yeah.
After completing your PhD in 1965, you went back to Caltech, and that turned out to be a very productive time for you, didn't it? Starting your own group, gathering a team of researchers.
It was wonderful. I arrived at Caltech at a time when the great, most exciting area of physics was high-energy physics, or the theory of fundamental particles. But it was in the doldrums, it happened to be at that time. And so there were a number of really brilliant young budding theorists who had gone to Caltech planning to work in elementary particle physics. And here comes this young kid out of Princeton with full of ideas for work in relativity, where there was a huge burgeoning. It was the beginning of what I like to call the golden age of black hole research. And so they glommed onto me, and as a postdoc, I wound up running a research group that had 5 graduate students and several postdocs myself. And so they couldn't do anything except give me a professorship.
We're not bad by the age of 27 at Caltech. That's pretty good going.
It was a different era than the present era, and Caltech is a different kind of institution.
Of course, then the 60s, as you say, was a golden period for studies of relativity. This is in part thanks to a series of remarkable astronomical discoveries, the discovery of quasars, pulsars, cosmic microwave background radiation. We don't have time to go into all of these, but they all involve relativity theory. Yes. The main thing to say is that they did lead to the creation of this new field of relativistic astrophysics. How would you summarize that subject?
So the relativistic astrophysics deals with those things in the universe where gravity is so strong that Newton's description of gravity can't begin to explain what's going on. And you have to use Einstein's general relativity laws instead.
And that includes black holes,
includes pulsars, includes cosmic microwave background radiation, and gravitational waves. The first three having been discovered in that era, gravitational waves, the quest to search for them was just beginning at that time.
Well, a theme throughout your career has been the importance of collaboration. And around that time, you were building connections with some of the world's leading authorities in the field in relativity, including an extremely influential group of researchers in Moscow.
Yes, the very best work in relativistic astrophysics was being done in Moscow, in the UK, and in the US. And I had studied Russian as an undergraduate, took 2 years of Russian, with the expectation that I would be working in an area where the Russians were really strong. And so I began traveling to Moscow for collaboration very soon after I got back to Caltech and started my professorship.
And you're collaborating with them in particular in the study of black holes. What was the contribution there? What was the actual problem you were looking at?
Well, so let me just say first that there was a leader of the group there named Zeldovich, who together with Andrei Sakharov was the father of the Soviet hydrogen bomb.
And Sakharov, of course, we now know more as the Nobel Peace Prize winner, the dissident.
Right. Yeah. And he became a dissident. But they, when I asked them, why did you build the bomb for Stalin? Well, Stalin had passed away, but why did you build the bomb for Beria and for the people who followed on? When they agreed, they knew that the Russian regime was not a very healthy regime. They said, we were scared to death that the Americans would do a preemptive nuclear strike on us if we didn't have nuclear weapons too. As shows up in the movie Dr. Strangelove and showed up in the pronouncements of General Curtis LeMay, who was the head of the Strategic Air Command, who advocated just that. They were scared to death of that, and so they built a bomb. And with Zeldovich and Sakharov being the theorists who designed the bomb. But they had both turned their attention to astrophysics at that time. And so I built a collaboration with Zeldovich's group. So Nick Shakura and Rashid Sunyaev in that group, they had the idea that X-rays were coming from disks of gas around small black holes. And these X-rays were being seen, there were X-ray sources. And so they started doing using Newtonian gravity, building models for these disks. And I was exposed to that in Moscow, and so I just jumped on it. And this was the first of many situations where I got ideas from the Russians, and I ran with them, and so I focused in on building fully relativistic models for the disks around black holes, which really are do play a major role, we now know, in astrophysics.
And of course, your collaborations with the Moscow team were going on clearly in this time, at the height of the Cold War, when relations between the USA and Soviet Union were very strained, even more so than today. And yet there you were, traveling back and forth. I mean, did that cause you any problems?
Not for me. Every time I met with one of my Russian colleagues, that colleague would be debriefed by the KGB afterwards. Every time I met with Russian colleagues, the CIA and the FBI never came around to debrief me.
Why?
Well, because I told my friends to whom the CIA and FBI did talk that I would not cooperate. And they, including, there was one such conversation between John Wheeler, who'd been my PhD mentor, and the Secretary of State, and the very high levels of the government. My personal relationship with these Russian scientists was viewed by my colleagues, and evidently by the American government, as a very useful thing to maintain those kinds of scientific contacts and for the promotion of science as a truly international endeavor.
Right, Kip Thorne, time to get into gravitational waves and the science behind that first detection. But set the scene for me first. It's now the 1970s. Very briefly, what's the thinking around gravitational waves at this point?
So Joseph Weber, a very creative physicist, had designed and built a gravitational wave detector and thought he saw gravitational waves, but he actually had not. And then a number of other groups built detectors and didn't see the waves. But Ray Weiss at MIT had invented a new, different type of gravity wave detector, which is the type with which we ultimately had success. I was very skeptical. I thought I knew, and in fact, I turned out to be right, approximately how strong the gravitational waves were, the strongest waves bathing the Earth. And I didn't see how his detector, or once I really understood Weber's detector, how they could possibly succeed. And I even, in the textbook that I co-authored, I even had a line that wrote a line in there that described Weiss's detector and said, this is not very promising. I then spent most of my career trying to help him make it work. But so So it took me 3 years to become convinced that the experimenters with his design had a real shot at success if we worked very hard for several decades. And I made the decision then that this was so important for the future of science that I, given that we had a shot at it, that we I would devote most of the rest of my career and that of most of my students to trying to help the experimenters succeed.
Well, in 1976, you asked Caltech to fund a research project dedicated to gravitational wave experiments. They backed you. Your new research group started building a prototype by 1984, LIGO, the Laser Interferometer Gravitational Wave Observatory.
Let me just say that we built our effort around Ronald Dreher, whom we imported from Glasgow.
Right.
And Dreher and I and Ray Weiss then founded this LIGO project.
And it took a while to get off the ground, to be built. It was a huge undertaking.
Yeah.
I should just note here, your research wasn't entirely LIGO-focused at this point, because you were also thinking about other things, more exotic things like wormholes and space travel. I'm going to come back to that shortly, but for now we're staying with LIGO. In the early 90s, you finally got approval to begin the construction. By the time it really gets going, we're talking about hundreds of scientists in an international collaboration. And at that point, you decided to take a step back from day-to-day involvement.
Yeah, so it grew to 1,000 scientists. We brought in Barry Barish to lead the effort, and he shared the Nobel Prize with Ray Weiss and me in the end. He's a superb leader and organizer. But by about 2004, I felt that the younger generation of theorists that I had trained were just as capable as I was of doing the things that theorists needed to do on this project. I got concerned that we didn't have an adequate capability to simulate collisions of black holes, because I was fairly sure the first thing we would see would be collisions of black holes, and we would not be able to understand the waves we saw unless we had computer simulations of the collisions. We just couldn't understand the waves without computer simulations. And so I built at Caltech a research group working on that in collaboration with a former student of mine at Cornell who had a very strong group, but not yet strong enough to pull it off successfully. Mm. And this collaboration, we called it the SXS collaboration for simulation extreme space times. We got the simulations working and robustly and with the capability of doing them fast enough to keep up with the data as the data came in, only a year or two before LIGO saw the waves. So it was sort of nip and tuck to get that done.
Just in time. Well, it was early one morning in September 2015, the team made its first direct detection of gravitational waves. Do you remember hearing the news?
Oh, yes, I remember very well. I woke up that morning. I had an email from Christian Ott, a young professor at Caltech. And Christian said, go look at such and such a website, an internal LIGO website. We might have a detection. And I went and looked. And this website had been constructed automatically by a computer software that was working off the incoming data. It hadn't been touched by human hands yet. But the data were too good to be true. I couldn't believe this was real. And I knew that in our previous incarnation, this was the second generation of detectors that we had built, that we had had blind injections that were put in order to really test the entire system, inject a false gravity wave signal by pushing mirrors back and forth. And so I said to Christian, this must be a blind injection. He said, I'm on the little committee that does blind injections, and we didn't do it.
So it's the real thing.
And it was the real thing, but it took several months to be absolutely sure.
Not only, of course, did that discovery confirm prediction of Einstein's theory, what I find also so powerful and beautiful is that it opened up a new way of us to look at the universe, because everything we know about space, we know because capturing light, electromagnetic waves. Now there's a different kind of waves that can tell us what we're seeing.
That's right. In fact, that was motivation from the very beginning for me. That the laws of physics say there are only two types of waves can be created in the distant universe and travel across the universe, bringing us information about what's out there. Electromagnetic waves, and that includes light, X-rays, radio waves, the whole spectrum, and gravitational waves. It was Galileo started instrument-based electromagnetic astronomy, and so our goal was to do what Galileo did for gravity waves.
And that's yet to come.
Team of 1,000 people pulled it off. The Nobel Prize should have gone to the team. It only went to three of us.
That is, I guess, an issue people have with the Nobel Prize, because 2 years later, 2017, as you mentioned, it was awarded to you, Ray Weiss, Barry Barish. There's also, a journalist described it as an announcement that surprised no one. Yes, you probably feel, there's been lots of Nobel Prizes involving large collaborations. Discovery of the Higgs boson is another example, I guess.
So I got the call at 2 a.m. in the morning in Pasadena. I was virtually sure it was coming. We were all virtually sure it was coming. And the guy at the other end said, it will not surprise you that the Nobel Prize is being awarded to you, Barry Barish, and Ray Weiss for this. And I said, it doesn't surprise me at all, but I'm very disappointed. It should have gone to the entire team. And he said, we'll discuss that when you get to Stockholm.
But they haven't changed those rules. Do you feel that this idea, the Nobel Prize is only awarded to a limited number, three people, is something that should change?
It should. There's another prize called the Breakthrough Prize, which is doing it the manner I regard as right. They have chosen, in a case like this, to offer the prize to several, typically three, but can be more, lead individuals, one-third of the prize to them, and two-thirds to the entire team.
Right.
And that's what they did with gravity waves. They gave the prize to three of us. In that case, it was Ron Drever, Ray Weiss, and me. And then two-thirds of the prize went to the entire team. So everybody on the team got a check for... You can do the math, but it was something like several thousand dollars, $2,000, I think.
And it was a big team.
And it was a big team of 1,000 people. So it's a $3 million prize.
Yeah. Okay, looking at the time, we're doing well. We've got about 15 minutes. Good. Thank you, Lucy. Okay, we now come to another chapter in your professional life, Kip, taking physics to the movies. I want to first of all start by traveling back in time. I want to start by traveling back in time, if you'll forgive the analogy, to the late 80s, when you were encouraged to start thinking about wormholes by none other than Carl Sagan.
Yeah, Carl Sagan called me up. He was a dear friend from going way, way back to about 1970. He said, I have this movie Contact that I'm working on, and a novel that will come out before the movie does. And the novel I have in page-proof form, so it's all set in type, and the publisher didn't want to change the makeup of the pages. He said, but I have my heroine traveling through a black hole to get to the vicinity of the star Vega. And he said, I think I may be in trouble. Can you help me? I said, yes, you're in trouble. You can't go. If you go into a black hole, there's a singularity, and you're going to die. So you should use a wormhole instead. But I said, the trouble is that John Wheeler and a student of his years ago showed that wormholes are unstable. They implode before you can get anything through. And so I got to go think about this. And so I thought about it and very quickly came to realize something that it turned out other people had discovered, a guy named Gannon had discovered before me, that the only way to hold a wormhole open is to put inside it something that anti-gravitates. And if it is to anti-gravitate, it has to have negative energy, which is equivalent to negative mass. I came to call that exotic matter. And so I said, told him, you've got to fill your wormhole with exotic matter, then you, maybe some very advanced civilization has built this and can hold it open. And so he rewrote big pieces of that novel in page-proof stage, which his publisher was not happy about.
So when the movie was made and Jodie Foster goes through the wormhole, she's quite safe coming out the other side. Of course, the other thing that you and your group then realized very quickly is, of course, a wormhole doesn't just join two points in space, but two points in time. Suddenly, you've got something that can act as a time machine.
If the two mouths of the wormhole are at places where time is flowing at a different rate, one of them may be just near a black hole, for example, and the other one is out in intergalactic space. Or one of them goes out on a twins paradox trip at very high speed and comes back. It will immediately become a time machine. And so converting a wormhole, if you have the technology, converting a wormhole into a time machine is dead easy if you have the technology.
The theory is all there in place. And of course, all this stuff really laid the groundwork for your own first foray into film. Tell me about Interstellar, how that came about.
So this is a movie where Linda Obst, who had been my girlfriend some years earlier, I was too nerdy for her, and she was too intense for me. So we just became friends instead of girlfriend and boyfriend. Some decades later, she had been Carl Sagan's primary producer on Contact. And so that's actually how I got to know her. And so after Carl passed away, she called me and said, would you like to brainstorm with me for a movie? And I said, yes, absolutely, this should be fun, and maybe we could make a movie that will inspire young people to get interested in science. And so that movie became Interstellar.
Mm. And of course, your involvement, once it got taken up, I think first by Spielberg and then Christopher Nolan.
Yes, and it, so I, the because the movie began with Linda and me, we built science into the fabric of the movie from the very beginning. When Spielberg came on to direct it, and he was the director through the early creative phase, he embraced this, and we worked with him to expand the science that was in there. But then Spielberg carries along more movies in the creative phase than he can possibly make. He was carrying along the movie Lincoln the same time as Interstellar, and he had to make a choice. He made the right choice for him. He chose Lincoln.
Yeah, well, not and, for most of the audience here.
Well,
I mean,
no.
Daniel Day-Lewis is a great actor, but man, that was a boring film.
No, but it was the right choice because I think Christopher Nolan made Interstellar into a much better movie than Spielberg would have. So Christopher Nolan came on board, and I brainstormed with Chris's brother, Jonah, who was the screenwriter during the Spielberg phase. And then I brainstormed with Chris on the movie. And so all the science in there and how it's integrated in the film as a result of brainstorming that I had done with Linda Obst, then with Jonah Nolan, then with Christopher Nolan, then with Paul Franklin, the double negative visual effects house.
The CGI.
Yeah. And it was just a fabulous experience for all of us. We just had a ball on this movie.
I mean, it is remarkable that, you know, when I talk about it, when I give talks to school kids, I say, you know, there's nothing there that breaks the laws of physics. That's what's wonderful. Gets a bit trippy towards the end when Matthew McConaughey's floating behind his daughter's bookcase in the fifth dimension. You think, it's hard to depict five dimensions.
So when we were discussing in depth that part of the movie, and the ideas behind that part of the movie were largely from Chris, not from me. But I embrace them because we manipulated them to the point that I had a very good scientific explanation for what goes into it. And Chris said to me, once we had gone through that process and reached an agreement, a meeting of the minds, he said, now you can write a book about the science of this movie and you can explain. He had told me much earlier, I want to make a movie that has as mysterious an ending as 2001, A Space Odyssey, which he greatly admired, Stanley Kubrick's masterpiece. I want my movie to have just as mysterious an ending or more. And so then he said, invited me to write the book that explains what's going on at the end.
His creative thinking.
So if you want to understand, you got to go buy my book.
And of course, this was the start of a beautiful working relationship.
Yes.
You later helped Chris Nolan on the physics of his sci-fi thriller Tenet.
Yes.
And as we alluded to earlier, you then advised on Oppenheimer. In fact, you advised Cillian Murphy on his portrayal of Oppenheimer in that movie.
No, it was just a great joy working both with Chris and with Cillian on that film. I was not deeply involved, just at a very modest level, but they are both so talented. And the movie is a masterpiece. Mm. And I'm very proud that I had this small role in helping make it.
Well, Kip, your journey into the creative arts hasn't stopped at movies. I'm thinking particularly of this multimedia project you worked on with composer Hans Zimmer.
Hans Zimmer and Paul Franklin. So we did several multimedia concerts in which I collected from astrophysics colleagues the videos that were made from computer simulations of things like black hole collisions, black holes tearing stars apart, the birth of the universe. Paul Franklin and his team at DNAG, it's now called, here in London, they edited those films to make them fit Hans Zimmer's music. And so then we did concerts where Hans would play the music with the videos scrolling across the screen.
Black holes and wormholes.
Black holes colliding, wormholes, the universe being born and evolving. And after a prologue, we stopped and Hans talked about the music. I talked about the science that was in the videos. Paul Franklin and Oliver James, the chief scientist at DNAG, talked about the videos that had been made of the science in the film. And then we went on with the rest of the concert. And we had, one occasion, we had Brian May as a guest musician on it.
This was at the Starmus Festival.
That's where I first met you back in 2017
in Tenerife. Yeah, that was... I mean, just to say, the CGI that Paul Franklin and his team put together for the movie, because it had Hollywood funding, those simulations are so powerful and so good and so accurate. They're used by researchers in academia.
That's right. No, I've used them
for serious science
to understand much more deeply gravitational lensing, we call it, by black holes. It's been a joy working with the team at DNAG here in London.
And of course, if all of that wasn't enough, you have just published an illustrated book of poetry out this year as well.
Well, I would put it a little differently, that it's a book of tightly integrated verse and paintings. The painter, Leah Halloran, and I got together on this, and we created it to the paintings and the verse jointly, with a give and take. It was enormous fun. I have enormously enjoyed these collaborations with artists and musicians and filmmakers. This phase of my life is, I decided in 2009 that I wanted for the second half of my career. I'd been a professor for 50 years. For the next 50 years, I wanted to devote a lot of that time to collaborations with people in the arts. Mm-hmm. And I am enjoying this thoroughly.
What? We're going to wrap up in about 5 minutes and then hand over to questions from the audience, but let's go briefly back to your science, Kip. You're part of a massive step forward for astrophysics and our understanding of Einsteinian gravity throughout your career. What's the next leap forward in physics, do you think?
Well, the one that I am most excited about is to try to understand in depth the birth of the universe, how it was born, what went on in the Big Bang singularity, as we call it, and simultaneously to come to grips successfully with the laws that governed the birth of the universe, which are the laws of what's called quantum gravity. These quantum gravity laws, we have some indication of what they might be. The best approach to them, I think, is what's called string theory or M theory. And it's a set of ideas that have been very popular among my physics colleagues that I've never worked in. Let me just say that I chose, even though I regard that as the most exciting area of physics and has been for most of my career, I never worked in it because it was a crowded field. And I wanted elbow room. I made my own way, helping to create new directions elsewhere. Those laws of quantum gravity that are basically a synthesis, a fiery marriage, as John Wheeler used to say, of general relativity, Einstein's laws, and the laws of quantum physics. They have been the holy grail for theoretical physicists for decades, and still are. And I think it likely that we will, that a big role in cracking the nut of understanding these laws is going to be simultaneously using them in perfect form, in a not perfect form, to explain what's coming off the Big Bang, and in particular gravitational waves from the Big Bang. Going back and forth between what the gravitational waves that were produced in the birth of the universe tell us and the theory of quantum gravity. And that's going to happen somewhere around the 2050, 2060 time frame when we have new technologies and new gravity wave detectors. And I'm just tremendously excited about this.
It's interesting because I've never heard anyone put a predict a date for when that might happen, 2050, 2060.
Good. I was overly optimistic on LIGO, so maybe I'm overly optimistic here.
And since you seem to have moved on to wanting to collaborate with the arts more, what's next for you personally? I hear you might have another movie idea up your sleeve.
Yeah, well, Stephen Hawking and Linda Obst and I initiated another movie. It must be close to 20 years ago now, maybe 15. And it's died 8 deaths. Now a cat has 9 lives. I'm hoping it stays alive this 9th time. But it's standard. The whole structure of how Hollywood works has been changing in recent decades, and how you make movies online dissemination of films. And China first becoming a major customer for movies, and then shutting that off sharply with the freezing of relations with China. So things have been changing rapidly, and whether our movie is going to survive all this, I don't know. But if this movie dies, I'll turn it into a novel.
Okay, good. So, no plans to slow down just yet?
No. Life is much too interesting. There's too many really interesting things to do and to learn about. Yeah.
Wonderful. Well, listen, Kip, I that's probably enough from me. I'm going to turn it now over to the audience here at the Royal Institution to ask you some questions. So we have the house lights coming up. If you'd like to ask Kip anything about black holes, gravitational waves, relativistic stars, Hollywood stars. See what I did there? Raise your hand and we get a microphone to you. There's a hand immediately shot up there, just so, because you're directly in my eye line, sir. So you get first dibs. And then
Thank you very much for a very interesting talk altogether, entertaining and profound. As a non-scientist, I understand that you're a specialist in relativity theory and practice, and that you're a specialist, Jim, in quantum physics. And as an ignorant person, I understand that these two are actually incompatible. You did mention quantum physics coming into your work recently, but could you say, I understand there is a kind of incompatibility between the theories of quantum physics and the basis of relativity. Do you see that being resolved?
Is it 2050 or 2060, I think?
let me just say that in fact, in my work, I use a lot of quantum physics and have used a lot of quantum physics. And particularly interesting is a whole new technology that we have developed for LIGO called quantum measurement technology, which we have a noise source in LIGO that we're dealing with right now, is that the LIGO measures gravitational waves by their moving mirrors back and forth relative to each other, and you monitor the motion with laser beams. But the mirrors, and LIGO is designed so that all you see is the motion of what we call the center of mass of a mirror. So the mirror behaves like a particle, a 40 kilogram particle. Now, elementary particles, electrons, protons, atoms, they're governed by quantum mechanics, and their positions are uncertain, and they jiggle around, and you can only say a probability for where the particle is. You can't say where it is. The same problem occurs with these mirrors in LIGO. They jiggle, and they jiggle at the level of our current technology. And we have had to invent a new technology so we control that jiggle. We don't make the jiggling go away. You can't make it go away. But we control the probabilities distribution for the jiggling. We control what's called the wave function of the jiggling in fancy terms for physicists. But the fact that we're doing this, we're doing quantum measurements on 40 kilogram particles of the sort that people normally do just with electrons and protons, is just fabulous. And this is another thing that has come out of LIGO, and the seeds for this, the ideas for this, began with collaboration between me and a Russian, Vladimir Baginsky, and the most important idea came from one of my students. And that has been, through my career, that has been the case, that my students have had enormously important ideas, much more important than any idea I ever had. My fame is that I have created an environment in which students could do this.
Oh, hello. Okay, hi. Hello, can you hear me?
Yep.
Hi, Kev. So, my name is Cecilia Yutz. Can you please settle an argument for me? I'm a professional artist, and I'm also a sustainable economist. I spent 4.5 days arguing with an MIT mathematician about the use of the word infinite and infinity. He was of the opinion that transdisciplinary work shouldn't invoke mathematical terminologies that would lead to confusion. Would you mind settling this argument for me? Thank you.
Good luck.
I think you're the best
authority for The laws of physics are written in the language of mathematics, as best we can tell. And the most advanced laws of physics, the things that are the deepest, the things that physicists have been struggling with the hardest and the longest in recent decades, make use of some of the very most advanced mathematics that there is, including concepts of infinity and how you control these the infinities that you run into. But translating that into everyday language is a lot harder than translating black holes and wormholes into everyday language. And so, to the extent that your mathematician friend is complaining about the use of the word infinity after you've tried to translate it into everyday language. I don't have the wisdom or the authority to comment on that, but he does. But in fact, as a working physicist, infinity is one of the tools that that we use and that that plays a major role in the theoretical work that is done.
We can't avoid dealing with infinities.
We can't avoid it.
We may want to. But
that's right. Just like we can't avoid dealing with quantum fluctuations.
Right. We have another question down here, and then front row, and there. That's two more, and then up there. Right. Yes. You're next. Then.
Good evening, Jim. Good evening, Kip. Firstly, I'd like to say that when you said that your inspiration for working in the arts, being a scientist, astrophysicist yourself, is to inspire the younger generation, I am a testament to that. I watched Interstellar at the age of 15, and that was what led me into studying physics, studying maths in higher education, eventually studying maths at the University of Cambridge. My question today is about something you said about wormholes. Which caught my attention. So the way I understood wormholes for the longest time was that just like there's a hole in the middle of a donut and an ant can crawl through the hole to reach the other side of the donut, similar to that, a wormhole is a path through space that would otherwise, to a seemingly unaware observer, connect two very far away points in space and time. But today you said that wormholes collapse too fast and require exotic matter to keep them open. And I was wondering if you could elaborate on what the difference, what the discrepancy between my understanding is and the correct understanding.
So if you take your donut and you make it out of rubber, and it's very, very stiff rubber, the hole wants to be infinitesimally small, but you've opened it up artificially, so it's really big, and then you let it go. The rubber just snaps it closed, and that's what's going on here. It's just of that sort, that if an ant is trying to crawl through the donut hole, the ant will get squashed when the rubber is let go and it goes crashing down. And so the issue is, how do you, in the real world, hold your donut open when the donut is made of warped space-time and not from rubber?
And what kept it open in Interstellar?
Well, in Interstellar, we presume that a very advanced civilization has made this wormhole. You find the characters in the movie commenting on this. And has placed it, in fact, in this solar system to offer humanity an out as the Earth is becoming uninhabitable. And so there is this higher civilization that has done all this, and they presumably have threaded through the wormhole enough exotic matter to hold it open.
Fantastic. Thank you so much.
This is an example of the issue that Christopher Nolan and I discussed, that all of the highly speculative ideas, and this is one, would come from science and not just from the brain of a screenwriter.
Okay, so we have a question up there, then we're coming down to the front.
First of all, I just want to say it's a real honor to hear about your fascinating career in your own words, so thank you for that. But my question's about exploring the interior of wormholes. When Jim taught most of us here about quantum mechanics a long, long time ago, there was there wasn't much on the syllabus about the idea of entangling black holes to make wormholes, so we didn't really talk about it much. But if you do manage to make a wormhole somehow, and Alice and Bob jump in, where is the interior of the wormhole? where is it? I'll just add finally on that question that I asked Lenny Susskind the same question, and he said, maybe it's an abstract formal space, and then said, maybe it's in Brooklyn. So where is the interior of the wormhole? Or does the question not even make sense?
I don't understand the question. Say it again.
Yeah, where is the interior?
Where is it?
Yeah, where is the interior of the wormhole when you're inside it?
Okay. Well, so I prefer to think of the wormhole as being embedded in a higher dimensional space, for which I'll borrow the word bulk from physics. It doesn't have to be that that's the case. The higher dimension doesn't actually have to exist. But I would be a little surprised if wormholes can exist. I'd be a little surprised if the higher dimension doesn't exist. And so I just think of it that way, that it's the wormhole is embedded in this higher dimensional space. You ask, where is the throat of the wormhole? Well, it's in the higher dimensional space between the upper sheet and the lower sheet.
There's a movie, isn't there? I can't remember who it is who says, look, this is what a wormhole is. It takes a piece of paper, folds it over, and punches a pen through it. Yeah, paper is two-dimensional space, and the pen is the wormhole.
Yep. That's Interstellar.
That's Interstellar.
is the character. That's a character named Romilly, who's an astrophysicist and goes on this trip together with.
I knew that.
And and who dies on the trip because a robot named Kip explodes and kills him.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for an interesting evening. I just wanted to ask, so you worked on a project which obviously was very challenging at times, like it was going to be very hard to get a detection. So for the people who are now maybe starting out their careers who want to work on quantum gravity, as you were talking about, the next big thing, what was the thing you learned or the one piece of advice that you'd pass on to the scientists that are starting work on this now and have, you know, decades ahead of them to get to this if 2050, 2060 is the right day?
So I would put it in very general terms. If you want to do something that's very difficult and have it make a real mark on the world on something that's very difficult, you really should pick something that's a lot of fun. In fact, it was my grandfather who gave me this advice. He said, when I was 4 years old, he said, Kip, when you grow up, if you find a job that's like play, you will be a success. The LIGO was enormous fun, and we enjoyed it thoroughly, and never thought about quitting because we were having too much fun. You need to love it if you're going to do it.
Thank you. Yeah.
Hello. As you've said, you want to collaborate with more artists going forward. Is there anyone in particular you've not had a chance to collaborate with yet that you'd love to?
So, not in particular, but in fact, that touches on a general philosophical attitude that I've had for a long time, and that is watch for unexpected opportunities. And they will come along from time to time, and evaluate them carefully when they come, and make a decision of whether to jump or not. But keep watching for them. And that's what happened with me on all of these collaborations that I have done in the arts, but also on LIGO on numerical relativity collaboration. These were never things that I intended to do. There were always things that came along that just seemed so exciting, so much fun, that I jumped.
Thank you. Right.
I have a question about the politics of funding science. Sorry. So it sounded like when you were planning the first LIGO, I think you said it yourself, third generation was probably not sensitive enough to detect. And you kind of knew that, but you also had to pitch that to get funding, hoping that second generation would be successful Like, how did that work? Can you comment on that? Was there consensus within the team that that's okay? Or were some people positive that even the first generation would be enough? And how were you pitching that?
So I think it seemed very likely the first generation of these instruments would not be enough. There were only a few of us involved in it at that very early stage. This was the stage where we submitted a proposal to construct LIGO. And it was just Ray Weiss's group and my group, the Caltech group, and nobody else, just two institutions, like four major players. And we made a decision that I think was a very wise decision, that we would be absolutely honest with our funding agencies and with Congress and say that this project, if it succeeds, the payoff is likely to be enormous, but it has a moderately high risk of not succeeding. And success will require very likely two generations of instruments. The first generation we will build is not likely to reach the necessary sensitivity, and we're going to have to then move onward from that and build the second generation. Our proposal to the National Science Foundation for funding of LIGO said that, and that's the story we told to Congress, and Congress bought it. And when we finally had success, both Democrats and Republicans took great pride in having backed this project. It was high risk, but ultra high potential payoff, and it having paid off, in fact, in the end. It became a sort of a poster child for great high-risk science.
Thank you. Yes, right up the back.
Hello. Hi. Thank you for the evening. And it's part of your work is dealing with the vastness of space and the distances. And I think the gravitational waves came at about 1.6 billion light years away from, I think it was very far away. My big question is are those distances something that bothers scientists like you? Do you think about them? Is this happened ages and ages ago? Is it something that scientists like you think about, or is it just something that you have to deal with and accept?
No, I think about it a lot. I like to describe it, that this burst of gravitational waves that was the first one we saw, it reached the outer edges of our Milky Way galaxy 50,000 years ago, when on Earth our ancestors were sharing the Earth with the Neanderthals. And I like to think about it in terms of all the things that were going on in Earth over those billion years, and that this marvelous burst arrived in my lifetime at just the right time to give us this team of 1,000 this big success. I think it's just really beautiful that's the way it went.
Thank you. I think that's probably all we have time for, unfortunately. Huge thanks to our wonderful audience here at London's Royal Institution, and of course, Kip Thorne, thank you very much for sharing your life scientific.